Six candidates are in the running for three seats on Cupertino City Council. As part of the City Channel's ongoing coverage of this race towards Election Tuesday, you're about to see an up-close and personal introduction to one of those candidates. This is Candidates Q&A with hosts George Moore and Mei-Hui Huang, and featuring tonight's Cupertino City Council candidate, Patrick Kwok.
Hello and welcome to Candidates Q&A. My name is George Moore. I'm with the Cupertino Courier Weekly.
Hi, my name is Mei-Hui Huang. I work for World Journal. It's a Chinese language daily.
This evening we are honored to be joined by Council Candidate Patrick Kwok. Patrick?
Hi, how are you doing?
Hi, Patrick.
Hi.
Patrick, traffic seems to be a big issue. I was wondering what your goals are to improve the traffic congestion and overall safety.
I think traffic and safety, they all go hand in hand. Traffic, we have to resolve it at the regional level. There are two ways to approach traffic. Number one is the regional level, work with the state and the transit agencies to improve more transportation. The other one is the local level. We need to work with the city. We need to work with the district, especially in a school, where we can come up with a system where traffic can be improved. Let me cite you an example in Monte Vista High School, where you have a lot of traffic problem. And if I'm elected to be council, I definitely would like to work with the school district and also with the parents and teacher. They call a tri-school action committee to come up with a solution that is going to be a win-win. There's already a committee set up now looking into all kinds of possibilities along Monte Vista School. As you know, we have three schools all branching within very, very close proximity of each other. And traffic, you know, is something that everybody, you know, is concerned. And I would welcome all the input from everybody, from the parents, from the teacher, from the school, and look into some creative way to improve the traffic. For example, doing some minor modifications in the turnaround at in front of the school so that traffic can be more efficiently operated. And second is to encourage people to walk more, okay, bike more. And thirdly is to look at some areas like the Blackberry Farm, the Anson College, where the students can park their car over there and so that they can be shuttled or walk to these to the school sites. In doing so, you reduce the traffic along the McLaren. There are other ways you can do it too. You know, you can look at the school ground site and see if we can create more parking. And I know that there's a tennis court that need to be rehab, but maybe we can just turn the tennis court, you know, into a parking area. As far as city-wise is concerned, I would strongly support a study, a traffic calming study. Look at what are the problems, where are the major arterials, such as Stevens Creek and the Anza Boulevard, and adjust the traffic signal, have more patrol along the major corridor, especially in the school hours. Where you have the presence of more serif, because once you see that, they see the sign there, people will slow down. So the police officer's presence is very important in major traffic area. And as far as the school is concerned, staggering the starting time for three different schools will be definitely a way to reduce the traffic. You don't want everybody to start at the same time, everybody jammed in the same street and get in and out at the same time.
I know there has been 3 years you were for the Planning Commission. You're now the chairperson, right?
That's correct.
Uh-huh. But also we're talking about reducing the traffic. Mm-hmm. So your role as a chairperson in the Planning Commission, and we want to reduce traffic. What are you going to do about that?
Well, for every project that comes to the Planning Commission, we go through what they call an extensive environmental review. I'm also one of the members on the environmental review committee, along with one city council, the city manager, public works director, and planning director. So I play a very important role in looking at the impact of the environment. Traffic is a very important because we have a checklist. Does it create traffic? We look at the project that where we stand in terms of traffic. You know, right now we have a traffic rating of A, B, C, D. A is no traffic problem. D is very acceptable. So look at the number of trips, you know, that will be created as a result of the project, and where would it stand in terms of impacting the rating? You know, if it is current rating is D minus already, if the additional traffic coming in there, it will drop it down to lower than D minus, then that is totally not acceptable. And the developers and the proposals have to come up with a very, very strong traffic calming plan to mitigate the traffic problems. You know, and also want to make sure that you are not compounding other problems that people cut into the side street and, you know, affecting the neighborhood.
Thank you.
Is it realistic to believe that Cupertino can limit growth and still provide housing for the present and the future?
Well, growth is always an issue in Cupertino, but I would say smart growth, okay? You got to grow very smart. You know, look at all the other areas and go from there. You know, in the general plan, with the amendment of the general plan, the housing element is very, very important. The Planning Commission, chaired by me, has gone through a very extensive review of the housing elements of the general plan amendment. We had extensive four workshops where invite the general public for their inputs. But when you look at growth, you know, we look at areas where you have the major arterials area, such as Stevens Creek, the Anson Boulevard, or even Homestead, where you have some infills areas where we can put more housing in there. But you have to be very, very careful about the density. You don't want to build it too high. You want to make sure that houses are appropriate to the neighborhood. You look at the density, you look at the height, you look at the consistencies, but at the same time, you look at also the privacy. Make sure that you don't build a two-level houses too high that you affect the people privacy. Sure. That is very, very important. And houses being built, we really want to really very focus on the setback, because the setback requirements, we have the 15 or 20 feet setback, the side setback of 10 or 15 feet side setback, and also upstairs too. And we want to make sure that the privacy of the neighbors are protected, and make sure the windows are not in a position that you can look down into neighboring backyard. Screenings is very important. Windows which is above height level would be very, very important, because in order to look down into neighborhood, you have to stand on a stool. So something that we look at, and mainly the main is to look at whether it is compatible with the neighborhood. We need to be smart. We need to focus on the areas, on the major arterials where you have a lot of infill areas where you can grow into. But very sensitive areas and quiet neighborhood growth, we'll try to stay away from sensitive areas. But again, you know, it's something that if we control it, you know, we do the smart growth process, it is possible that we can have a moderate slight growth, but at the same time, keep the community and neighborhood in place.
Hi Patrick, my next question is about diversity. It's not because I know you're a Chinese American, I ask this question to everyone. Mm-hmm. Well, Cupertino is indeed a city of diversity, and based on the figure we got from Census 2000, we have population, you know better, about 50,000 mm-hmm. people here. And 44% of it is Asian, mm-hmm. and Chinese 12,000. So this is obviously population-wise diversity. What do you see this picture as? Do you think this is we really are diversified and culturally or ethnic wise? What kind of a role you're going to play trying to bridging the gap, if there is any gap or differences between different groups?
I think Cupertino is very, very fortunate. we have such a very diverse group of people from all races and coming to Cupertino because of it is a good community, an excellent community to live with. But at the same time, we need to bridge the gap. You know, bridge the gap means open the communication dialogue with the people. Make sure you feel them, they are welcome, they are appreciated. We can share the cultural diversity with a group. Cupertino has done a lot, okay? But there's still a more to go. You know, I like to see the continuation of community activities such as Shakespeare in the Park. Recently, we have the film festivals. Yeah. We draw 200 to 400 people per day. And that's the good time people look at films of different cultures and really appreciate what the other cultures are. The Moon Festival, which is scheduled next Saturday and Sunday, I happen to co-chair that festival, is another opportunity that people of all races can come in and enjoy the cultural richness, and the Moon Festival is inclusive to everybody. We change our focus now, not before used to just Asian activities. We have every other activities that people want to come in and share the cultural activities. Shakespeare in the Park is another one. July 4th is another one that is good because it does reflect our own American culture. Art and Wine Festival is another one. Oktoberfest is another one that we can bring everybody together and have fun. But mainly is to bring the community together that we are here as a community and we're here to share the cultural richness and appreciate the people of all races. I would like to see a multicultural fair on an annual basis in which we have different cultures, different people coming in and here and share the culture. Mm-hmm. I think we have a long way to go yet. You know, we're not there yet. And with the increasing number of populations coming into Cupertino, especially Asians, mm-hmm. I see more need of a cultural dialogue and bridging the gap. You know,
integrations
and make sure that these people, what is best for our community, not a particular race, but what is best for the community, how people can work together and come up with a win-win situation that everybody is happy and we have harmony within our community.
Thank you.
Well, you told me you had six children.
Yeah.
What goals do you have regarding the youth of Cupertino as far as just their opportunities or just for places for them to hang out, that type of thing?
Well, I want Cupertino to be a place where our children, our grandchildren can live and work in the community. I see the needs of a lot of youth programs, recreation activities that will bring the youth together. The expansion of the city sports center will definitely be a advantage to the youth. I like to, if I am elected, is to form a youth commission where we can bring the youth together and then we have one council member or one director from the city where they can meet on a regular basis and bring in their ideas. Because sometimes you say the parents, this is what the parents want, this is what the city wants. Well, we have to ask the youth, what do you actually want? Because their inputs are very important. The youth are the future generation, they are the future leaders of the communities. So we got to respect the opinions of the youth. We got to provide them with a good education program. Expansion of the library is something that I'm 100% supporting it. Expanding the recreation activities is something that I solely endorse.
Thank you.
Hi, Patrick. Six people are running. Only three are going to win. Mm-hmm. What do you think you can do a better job than the others? And if you are elected, what's the first issue you want to deal with?
This is very competitive field. I think every candidate is unique in their experience in characters. But I think I'm electable in the sense that I have 30 years of proven experience, both in the municipality and in public works. I'm a registered civil engineer. Of all the six candidates, there's no civil engineer in there. Because with the experience I gained in 30 years as a manager, I'm very, very strong in fiscal budget. You know, I see budget is one of my top priorities. I'll elaborate a little bit in there. I have the experience. I have the leadership. It's being proven. At the same time, I've done a lot of community services. I chair the Moon Festival, the Summer Festival. I'm also the board of directors with the Cupertino Y. I chair the 2001 YMCA community campaign that raised $132,000 in less than 2 months. Of course, the money goes back to the youth, and I want to tie into the importance of the activities for the youth. The YMCA is a good place where the youth can benefit, you know, from the programs, the maturity, the after-class program, all the sports, the summer camps, and that's why I'm so strong in supporting YMCA is a better community for the youth and everybody. Why am I am electable in a sense, the experience, and also I serve on the Planning Commission for 3 years. I know what the issues are. I have an opportunity in the past 3 years to interact with the citizens. So we have always an open dialogue with the citizens. I know what the community wants. I know what the citizens want. I know what is good for the city of Cupertino. The very, very first thing I will look at is the budget, the finance. Because of my strong finance background, I don't think, my opinion is that, you know, when you look at other candidates, which one has a very strong fiscal background, 30 years of community or municipal finance accountabilities. First, I will look at the city finance, okay? And I'm a very fiscal conservative in terms of running a budget. I know that in the past, 5 years, Cupertino has spent about $30 million in capital, mainly on the city center, which is $4.5 million, the sports center, which is $4 million, the library will be $22 million. So totally, you're adding about $30 million right there by the time the library is complete. I'm solely supporting of the library, the $22 million. No doubt about it, it's a worthwhile program. But at the same time, we are drawing our reserve on our general fund. Council mandate in 2000 set a goal of $15 million for reserve. The $50 million comes from half a year of operating expenses. If we have a natural disasters, or if we have an economic decline or uncertainty, that there will be a 50% of the total budget of $31 million that will go and pay the expenses to keep the city services going. And in 1996, we had a $33 million reserve, the undesignated expenses reserve that we can designate to something else. And right now, we only have a 19 or 17 million reserve. From the year 2003, we will have only $11 million reserve because of the construction of the library. So we are not actually following council mandate of keeping 50 million reserve if we go from the year 2003. So if I become city council, I would take a very close look at our expenditures to gradually build up the reserve. And I will look at efficiency, look at other ways to get revenues. I know that the new hotel is coming up in the corner of the Yenser and Stevens Creek will bring some revenue. But at the same time, you have to offset the economic decline in the valley, the high tech. Okay, they are pretty much next year or so. There are a lot of layoffs. There's a lot of taxes that might not be able to derive through our revenue. 35% of our revenue comes from tax. And look at the utility tax, the franchise tax. PG&E is bankruptcy already. And the vehicle licensing tax. Last year, we got the refund from the state. But it's being drawn from the vehicle licensing tax. And the governor has agreed that if we have any surplus, they will put it back to the vehicle licensing fee. But with the big energy crisis, there's not going to be any reserve. So our revenue from state subsidy is going to be much smaller portion. At the same time, when there is a statewide decline in revenues, the state will look at the local local tax system and see what they can do to raise the local tax system so that they can get more revenue. So you need a council that is fiscally conservative, look at all the aspects of revenues, be prepared of the declining economy, and look at some way to creatively finance project. At the same time, make sure that the project such as library is constructed on schedule and within budget. It's very important that the buzzword is on budget and within schedule, no overspend, and at the same time, we look at other things where we can be able to have some other savings in some other project. So my top priority, going back to your question, is finance budget. With my strong background in there, we need to look at the budget very, very carefully and make sure that the money is worldwide spent, and make sure that we rebuild our reserve to at least 15 million. We have a 32 million in 1996. It's gone down now. We need to gradually build it back up again.
Thank you.
Besides the budget, what do you think is the most important aspect in the revision of the general plan?
Housing is very important. Okay, open space is definitely very, very, very important. Traffic is important. The quality of life, the quality of life for the people, more recreations, you know, for the residents of Cupertino, more community service would be good in terms of doing the general plan revision. More walkable community where people can get out of the car and walk, because if you do that, you will reduce traffic, you will reduce pollution. I am an environmental engineer for the past 30 years. I know what it takes to reduce traffic, what it takes to reduce pollution, air and water pollution, so that the community can have a better quality of life for our generations to come.
Well, Patrick, Cupertino, like every other city, is changing. What do you want it to turn to be in next four years with you in the picture, and what you want it to be different from now?
As I mentioned to you, fiscal, I will be very, very look at the fiscal, the budget of our city, and make sure that we are in good shape and gradually build up the reserve. That is a must. And look at other programs where we will improve efficiency. Okay, I like to improve efficiency of the program, make sure we provide excellent quality customer services to the community, but at the same time, we operate the system in a very efficient manner. At the same time, I also want to see a way where we can improve the cultural understanding of the citizens we serve. Communication dialogue, more community activities, continue with the film festivals so that we can bring people together and look at it. I will be very also look at other creative ways to get revenues with the declining economies so that we can build up our revenues.
Yeah. Well, I'm curious, can you single out a specific moment? At that moment, you said to yourself, Patrick, you really have to run for the city council. When was that?
I decided to run for the city council about a year ago, okay? When I had the opportunity in the past, at that time of 2 years, to interact with the citizens and find out what the citizens want. I know that the citizens need to have a positive voice in the community, and I want to represent them. And the only way you can represent them to be sitting on the city council and serve the community. And that is how I decided to run.
What kind of occasion? You said 1 year ago you interact with citizens?
No, when I served on the Planning Commission,
okay,
as chair,
okay,
I had a lot of opportunity to interact with the citizen outreach. When we have a project that coming up, I always go out to the site, look at the situation in here, look at the impacts, talk to the laborers and see what are the impacts. How do they like the project? What elements of the project they don't like? Do they like the project at all? Like the Academy, Canyonville Academy that's coming up in here, definitely I would talk to the people and look at that. And the common theme of that project is that safety and traffic. That really tie in to our vision is to reduce the traffic and improve the safety of our community.
Yeah.
Patrick, I think we're wrapping things up. Thank you very much for being here, taking the time to come join us.
Thank you, mate.
Good luck with you.
Okay.
Good luck.
I think it's going to be very interesting to, a race because each of the candidates, they all have their unique background. You know, they all can serve, you know, but I believe that I can do a good job.
Tune into the City Channel for local election information and coverage through the November 6th election. Program schedules can be found at various locations, including City Hall, the Cupertino Public Library, the Cupertino Scene, and the City's website. While at the website, you can find more information on City Council candidates and on Measure D. You will also find helpful links to voter information pages. Exercise your right to vote on November 6th by heading to the polls.